Good morning, class of 2014. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. This is the 2012 IB Forum. This event is a long-standing tradition at George Mason High School. I think it's one of the many reasons why we are a very different high school from most high schools around us. At this pivotal moment as 10th graders, in about 4 weeks, you will have an assembly with your counselors where you will be asked to think about the classes you want to take next year. You met with me in physical education class to think about that as well, but we want you to hear from the most important voices in making decisions about your future. That's our graduates of this high school who have experienced 11th and 12th grade already. That's the point of today's forum. This is an informal event where you get to ask graduates of this high school questions. There are also two current students. We'll introduce them in a few minutes. This year's forum occurs at a special time in our school's history. Now, a huge majority of Mason seniors are completing one or more IB courses. You guys know the number. What's the number? Someone's teasing me. 88%. Thank you guys very much. 88% of seniors are taking one or more IB courses and exams. I have absolutely no doubt that the class of 2014 will continue on this path. But why does this matter? Is it important to take IB courses because it is impressive or because I get to brag about those numbers? Absolutely not. You guys remember what we talked about in your physical education class. Study after study shows that taking the most rigorous courses that are appropriate for you will help you succeed in your next steps in life. Why and how can IB courses help you in college if that's your next step? IB successfully emphasizes three fundamental skills that you have to succeed in the 21st century. The ability to read critically, to think, and to write. Very simple ideas, reading, thinking, writing. Shortly, you'll have the opportunity to choose courses for your junior and senior year, as I said before. In those 2 years, you'll be able to participate in the IB program. You can either take individual IB courses or exams, or you can take the full IB diploma program, as we recently discussed. For the first time ever, the class of 2014 will have the opportunity to take the IB Core Extended Essay TOK and Creativity, Action, and Service as certificates. We also are offering two new classes, IB Language and Literature, Continuation of CP English, and IB Film. Today's forum, as I talked about, is an important tradition. What makes it important are the 9 students sitting on the stage. These 9 students are all very different types of learners. They're here to talk to you about their experiences and how they relate to their life in college. After I introduce each of them, they're going to say a few words about why they wanted to participate in today's conversation. So I'm going to introduce the panel, we'll say a few words, and we'll move down to the next student. Our first panelist is Matthew Baker. He's a freshman at the College of William & Mary. He received the IB Diploma in the class of 2011. He's thinking about majoring in math and music. And he recently survived the William & Mary zombie apocalypse, which only a few students finished. So we're very proud of him about that. Matt, would you like to say a few words to your classmates?
Hey, I'm here today to help, along with the rest of the panel, to help show you guys how the IB program is really an opportunity for you guys to pursue the classes that you're interested in. So basically, don't feel that the IB program is something to be afraid of or that it's too much for you. I'm here to help show you guys that you can handle it, and it's really an independence for you to choose the classes you want to take.
Thank you, Matt. Hannah Boning has joined us. She's an IB courses student from the class of 2010. She's currently at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, studying dance and computer science, and she's excited that the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, is the first college to have a Bojangles restaurant on campus.
I was a certificate student, and so I have sort of a different perspective than most of the diploma students, so I'm just here to tell you about that.
Thank you very much. Katie Breen, also a graduate in the class of 2011, IB Diploma recipient. She's currently at Princeton University studying astrophysical science. And she recently met one of her most favorite astrophysicists at Princeton. That was quite an exciting moment.
Yes. Okay, so I guess I wanted to be on this panel because when I was a freshman and sophomore and sat through this panel just like you guys, I saw other students talk about their experience in the IB Diploma, and I knew I wanted to pursue the IB Diploma, and I knew I wanted to one day sit on this panel. So I guess I wanted to be on this panel to kind of fulfill my goal of and reach the capstone of the whole IB program.
Yeah. Catherine Camp has joined us. She's also a graduate of the class of 2011. She's an IB courses student. She's a freshman at the Columbia College of Art and Design studying photography. I hope all of you went to the IB art exhibition here on the stage last year. You probably remember Catherine's photographs. I was quite impressed by them as well. She currently works in the admissions office at Columbia College of Art and Design and gives campus tours. Catherine.
It's Columbus.
Columbus, what did I say?
Columbia.
Columbus.
That's okay. That's what
I, thank you.
That's okay. Yeah, so I'm mostly here. I didn't do diploma. I mean, in all honesty, I'm not as motivated to do that, but I'm a huge art fanatic, so that was the main program that I focused in. So if any of you are really, really interested in art, then I might be the person that you want to talk to, because I ended up going to an art school. So I'm here to help you guys with that.
And you were quite successful IBHL artist student.
Yes, I got a 6 out of 7 both years on the exam.
Eric Carlson has joined us from the University of South Carolina, where he's majoring in sports management. He graduated from Mason in 2011, also with the IB Diploma. He was kicked in the stomach by the school mascot this summer. So.
I'm here just because I struggled a lot with whether to do certificates or the diploma, and this definitely helped persuade me just to try the diploma, and ultimately helped me get the diploma, which has definitely helped me in college. So that's why I'm here.
Thank you. Peter Davis, a George Mason High School graduate of 2008, also an IB Diploma recipient. He's currently at Harvard. He's majoring in government there. And a very fun, interesting, recent factoid. Peter just returned from competing on a Japanese game show.
I'm really glad to be here because you're going to get a lot of messages during the next few weeks as you're thinking about this, about why you should take IB for private or personal reasons, like getting a job or getting into college. And I think it's important that you also remember a duty to take your most vigorous class for public reasons, that there are a bunch of great problems that our generation faces, that our world faces, and our generation is going to need to solve. And to have the critical thinking skills and the ability to think clearly, articulate your ideas well, and be real movers and shakers in the world to help make our world a little better is going to be very important, and IB is going to help you do that.
Thank you. In the last few years, students have asked the panelists some questions, and some of them said, I don't really remember 11th grade well enough to answer that question. So a new tradition has been to have current Mason students sit on the panel as well. And Christina Holman has been kind enough to join us today. She is a class of 2013, a junior IB Diploma candidate.
Hi, guys. I just want to let you guys know that I thought this panel is very persuasive and also provides a lot of information to help you figure out what would be the most rigorous program for you. And I know that a lot of you have questions about the transfer from 10th grade to 11th grade. And if you wanted to ask me kind of what were the effects of choosing the IB Diploma program, or what were some of the factors that went into deciding that decision, you can always ask those questions for me.
Another current Mason student, Geneva Jost, has joined us. She's a senior at Mason, and she's a diploma candidate.
Hey, guys. So I'm basically here to kind of let you know what it's like to be an IB diploma candidate as a senior, and also kind of dispute the myth that if you do the IB diploma, you won't leave your house and that you won't have a social life, because it's really up to you to manage your time, and you can do everything that you do if you were a diploma candidate or not.
And last, but absolutely not least, of course, Benjamin Tran, a class of 2011, graduate and IB Diploma recipient. He's at the University of Virginia, dual majoring in neuroscience and linguistics. Ben studied 3 different languages here as a Mason student, in addition to other languages outside of school, so linguistics makes sense for him. He is serving on the first-year judiciary committee, composing of 17 first-year judges. I believe that's the honor committee at UVA. Yeah. This must be a great honor for a freshman, I'd imagine.
So I had a pretty different experience with the IB Diploma. My CAS experience and my extended essay experience was very different. I came here to basically share those experiences and answer questions that you guys may have.
Okay, I'm going to begin today with a set of predetermined questions I'm going to ask the panel. However, if I ask questions the whole time, we're all going to fall asleep. So, you guys, I know you have questions because I just met with you the week before you were out for the winter holiday. Many of you stayed after asking all kinds of questions about your choices in the future. If you have a question today, all you need to do is get up and stand behind one of the two microphones in each aisle. I will call on you after I've asked, we've asked the current question we're in right now. The class of 2013 asked lots of questions. I hope you guys will continue in that tradition again. You guys remember what's one of the characteristics of IB students? Risk-taking, thank you very much. And I know we'll have a lot of risk-takers here who will stand up and ask us questions. But I'm going to ask the first question. This is just for our graduates. Now that you've interacted with graduates from both IB, AP, and other types of high schools, what do you feel you got out of the IB program that you don't think you would have gotten possibly in another program? And do you think there are any differences in the learning style in IB versus what your roommates or friends may have experienced in non-IB schools?
I mean, I guess what I've noticed most from IB to AP and then just regular high school courses is that IB definitely teaches you time management, and that's honestly the most important thing at college, because you will have free time. Like, that's inevitable, and how you use that free time will determine whether you're successful or not at college. And so I think IB definitely made me manage my time well enough so that I can be successful and yet still have fun at college. So.
I think IB is very analysis-based. You're required to often take in a lot of information through a lot of different ways and sort of put it all together and make connections and make it make sense to you instead of maybe just memorizing and regurgitating information. And that's a skill that will definitely come in handy at college because that's what you're going to be expected to do in courses. You're going to have to make connections on your own.
Would anyone else like to answer that question?
Pretty much every single IB course that I took here at George Mason has had an immediate impact on the courses I'm taking in college. I'd say that going into the college courses, I was a lot more prepared than some other students for not so much the rigors of college, but sort of the different mindset of the analysis and looking at things through different lenses. For example, I took a really cool jazz history course at college, and everything from my IB history and IB English writing skills that I learned to the TOK ways of thinking and ways of analyzing problems really helped me in my jazz course. And even though it might not seem that, you know, oh, here's a jazz history course, it's not really the same. You might think, oh, maybe IB music, which I took, would have helped me more, but all the courses I took had a huge impact on my college courses.
Does anyone else on the panel have a specific example of an assignment they experienced in college or a type of seminar where they were directly pulling from an experience they had in 11th and 12th grade?
I'll go. I took a seminar. It was called Silence and Noise, Music and Art as an Everyday Experience. So already you can tell just by the title of the name, it's going to be kind of, I like to call it like a hippy-dippy course because it was kind of abstract and stuff. And I found that my level of thinking was one step deeper than my classmates, and whereas they were talking about just more basic things just from the response from my teacher and how she affirmed what I said, I could just tell that thanks to courses like TOK and IB English that I was pulling in, like Matt said, things from different lens of thinking. So. Like science and math, I was able to bring that all into this class that we were looking at, into the topics that we were looking at.
Any other examples?
So my extended essay is set me on a trajectory towards kind of the stuff that I'm interested in today. I wrote my extended essay on third parties, and it was during an election year, And because I started looking into them and looking into and taking seriously a lot of the statements made by third-party candidates, it changed the direction of my politics, and it changed the direction of how I related to the world all through college. Because I can actually, that's not even a statement just for this panel. I literally, if I did not write that extended essay, I would be doing different things right now, like in my life. And I'm in a very different place because I wrote my extended essay.
One of the biggest concerns of 10th graders is they're choosing to take rigorous courses for 11th and 12th is workload. You guys can remember what high school was like. And this is a question current students can answer as well. Was IB all studying? Did you have a life outside of IB? How did your workload here compare to your expectations in college? Maybe some folks that haven't spoken.
Well, I'm now at an art school, like I said before, and so my main focus here, like pretty much the only IB class I took, aside from math, was art. So I considered myself really lucky that I had a good art program. I had a project in my design class in college that took me 10 hours, but I mean, if I hadn't had the experience here, it definitely would have taken a lot longer. So I really, really appreciate that. I've been able to push myself throughout high school to be able to do the things that I need to get done while I'm in college.
Catherine, would you be able to share specifically what it was in IB Visual Arts that prepared you for that 10-hour project that you're at?
Well, I don't know how well any of you know me, but I tend to get really big ideas for projects. So, I mean, that's kind of like, it doesn't really help me most of the time, but because that usually means that I have to really push myself to get what I want done. So because I did that, though, I guess it's also a good thing because I'm able to now narrow down what I want to do exactly really quickly, and so I can get started a lot faster because a lot of people like change their project halfway through the time period that we have to do it, and they usually don't really do that well.
Okay, I have this one. As far as being a junior, I don't find it that it's going to ruin my social life or I'm not going to have the time to do extracurricular activities. Although it might seem rigorous or challenging because I chose those courses, a lot of the teachers are actually willing to move the project or discuss some type of conflict that's going on or even extend the date or even help you. It's actually quite a nice environment to work in. I find the teachers very helpful. And then also, because of the rigorousness and the challenge, I've acquired a sense of time management that really has to do with kind of your development over time, and that's what the IB Diploma is about, creating a balanced person. And of course, you do have the kids who wait until the weekend it's due to do a 20-page paper. Well, we've never had a 20-page paper. That's an exaggeration. So, but I find that it's actually quite helpful.
I have to agree. I say, well, when I was your age and I went to this forum, there was a kid who said, I go to bed at 10:30 every night, and everybody goes, what? No, you don't. And I'm that kid. I go to bed at 10:30 every night. And I have to say, I think that definitely IB, everybody talk about this time management, it definitely helps you. And I don't do homework on Fridays or Saturdays. I'm going to be honest. I do procrastinate a little bit, but I am able to get everything done because I do manage my time, so you will have time to, you know, have a social life, you know, just be yourself as a high school student and not be totally swamped with work all the time, although it does require, you know, some time.
I don't think we call that procrastination. I don't do homework on Fridays or Saturdays either. We need a break in life, right? So any other perspectives on workload? I think that's wrong.
In terms of college, there is so much less work in college. High school was like a swamp of work, and I really credit that to my success in college on the ability to try new activities in college, to the fact that all the work in high school, as everyone has said, really helps you plan your time, learn how to manage your life. And also in terms of the work, if you take classes that you really enjoy, then the work isn't going to be as onerous or as boring, or it's not going to seem like a waste of time. So basically, if you choose courses that you're interested in and you're not, you know, forced by, you know, what your friends are taking or what people say you're supposed to take, then the work you're doing will be interesting and it won't take that much time.
Well, the work that I think that I did in high school was a lot. It was really helpful in the fact that it taught me how to collaborate with teachers. One of the biggest things in college is that you might not know your professor very well. So in high school, you may be able to speak with your teacher. You may be able to postpone a deadline or anything. But in college, it's a little bit different. So I think the best thing about the IB Diploma, from my experience, was that it really taught me how to be independent in my learning, and that I just was able to, once again, time manage. But then again, I was able to push myself, and most of the courses I took was actually really helpful in deciding my majors. But then I decided that my extended essay was on math. That was also really helpful, but then I changed to linguistics. But I think the courses here were very helpful in the fact that the teachers were also standing right beside me to help me through the process.
I'll also throw in, give, like in the spirit of saying, like finding things you care about in college and in collaboration, that rigorous, the word rigorous stems from rigor, as in rigor mortis, which is very connected to death, like stiffness and death. So if any of your classes are rigorous, then there's something wrong with one of your classes. What I found in many IB classes is that they were vigorous, which means enlivening. And what you'll discover is that in college, and in life, or at least my guess at life, so college life at least, is that what you got? What's going to make all the difference is that you find something that you care like hell about, and that's what's going to drive you forward. Something deeply inside that's going to make you care to keep waking up every day and in your work. And IB classes, many IB classes, when they're done right, and so many were done right when I was in high school, and I'm sure they still are today. Were vigorous, and if you can be a partner in that vigor in your class to make your class an enlivening class and to find things that you truly care about from the inside that enliven you, then you're going to do great in the IB, and the workload will be exciting, and you're going to do great in college too.
And to go on with what he's saying, because that's actually a wonderful point, Mr. Mishra always discourages us from having our motivation be grades. He wants your motivation to be something that you're really interested in, something that you're looking for, a goal or an aspiration to develop in that area. And you really want that to be your motivation because this is your IB program. This is really going to help define you, develop you, and prepare you for things that are going to happen in college or even after college, or even if you're not going to college, a gap year. This is why you need to actually focus on an area that you really enjoy and want to have an interest in.
And one last thing, I guess to sort of bounce off of what you guys have been saying, is that what I found through my experience with the IB diploma was that even though there might be a huge workload at times, you're not alone in it. Like, you're surrounded by your fellow students who are also going through the same thing. And I found that there was a just beautiful sense of camaraderie among the students that I really enjoyed, that were always there to give you encouragement along the way.
So you all shared positive responses to this workload question. I worked with most of you on this panel. Some of you I had to chase down the hallway to get your extended essays from you. So Ben, I'm especially thinking of you, Ben, in terms of, not with the dragging extended essay, sorry, for my next question. Ben, you were highly motivated. You were a leader in a lot of clubs. Did you ever think you overextended yourself? And would you go back and change at least how you handled that?
I would definitely say I think I overextended myself. CAS was really helpful in the fact that it made me recognize I overextended myself. If I look back upon it, I think I held a leadership position within at least 5 clubs, if not more. I'm not sure. I don't really remember. But it really helped me to recognize that I was taking too much on. And although I did take a lot on, it didn't really mean that I was getting very in-depth in them. After midway through senior year, I found that it'd be better if I only selected a few and then really pursued those entirely, rather than taking a broad sense and then trying to basically build up my resume and efforts to get into a really good college. But I didn't find that was really helpful to me personally in the long run, so I had to change that and then go to take specific activities that I really found enjoyable.
Mr. Foster recently shared a newspaper article with teachers here that was all about how colleges want to see significant extracurricular contribution rather than a long list of things. Did any of you have a 2-year commitment that you made to a service project that you would like to share with the group, and how that relates to your life now?
I mean, I'll say that I was really involved with the HD Cook project, which is going to the elementary school in DC and tutoring kids. And that's really changed me, just because when I first started doing it, I wasn't sure I was going to like it. I was honestly doing it just to get my CAS hours. But by the that sounds really bad now that I said it. But by the time senior year rolled around and I took more of a leadership role in it, it was more because I enjoyed spending my Wednesday afternoons going to DC and helping these kids learn and learn to like to learn. That sounds really weird, but like they were doing it just to get through school and say they did it, rather than like what the IB promotes, which is to like love, like be a lifelong learner is a phrase that's bounced around a lot. And so that CAS project ultimately changed me, and it made me more of a life learner than I was beforehand. So even if you don't do the diploma, I would strongly encourage doing the CAS as a certificate, now that that's an option, just because CAS, like, nothing wrong can come from community service. Like, it's one of those things where it always helps somebody grow, and that definitely needs to be encouraged.
Yeah, I did cheerleading all 5 years of high school. I also went to a summer language program for 10 years. So I haven't done many things, but I did what I did for a very long time, and I was committed to them. And so, I mean, like, over the summer, it's a language program, so I have homework and tests, so, I mean, that always kind of helped me. Also, my senior year, I volunteered in an animal shelter. So, I mean, considering my summers, I was spending a month off in, like, northern Minnesota with no access to any internet or anything. I mean, I did pretty well with that. And so, I mean, like, you can survive on working, and you still have fun. So, I mean, even with whatever you do, you can still find a way to enjoy what you're doing. So, I mean, I had a lot of my cheer practices throughout all the years, but, I mean, I still found a way to manage being able to enjoy that and still getting all my stuff done and not getting too stressed out.
Okay, I'm going to ask another question, but I know you guys from the conversations we had last week. I know there are a lot of courageous learners in this group who have questions. I would love to see you get up and ask these folks some questions. You're going to fill out a course selection sheet in 4 weeks. And based on our conversation, I'm confident that you have a few questions about your options. Theory of knowledge is a certificate option for your class, yet I don't think my explanation for what the class was clear or sufficient. So those of you that took TOK, can you describe the TOK class and explain your feelings about that experience?
So theory of knowledge is about knowing how to know. And you go through ways of coming to knowledge, different ways of determining truth, and different areas, like different areas of knowledge, like mathematical knowledge, scientific knowledge, political knowledge. Like, is a photograph true? How is a map true? And this was the best class I took in high school, because it's basically like the ultimate foundational critical thought question. And just to tell you why it's important in our day and age, there's 3 different presidential candidates right now, one of which says that we should pull all of our troops out of all of our foreign military bases, one that says we should bomb Iran, all of these are direct quotes, and one that says we should do something in the middle more, and one that says we should do something in the middle less. All these people are talking on TV and telling us all these things. And we're citizens in this country, and we have to determine if we're going to agree with that or fight for one side or the other or advocate for something or the other. And when you have 4 different leaders that are all saying different things, how do you determine who's telling the truth? And one option is to just say, oh, I like this guy or that guy's personality. Another option is to use your knowledge from TOK to really determine from a foundation of inside of you, not just trusting someone else, what is true about our world. And in a world with so much information, so many people telling you so many different things, it's so important to have that base of truth inside of you and that pathway to finding truth on your own. And that's what critical thinking really means. And that's what TOK is going to teach you how to do if you pay attention to it and engage with it vigorously.
Probably for me, the best part of TOK was that it combined all the classes together and allowed you to look at each class you're taking, not within the specific realm, say you're taking, you know, math. In math class, you just look at it from a mathematical standpoint. You don't see how it's maybe similar to some other classes. But in TOK, you're able to look at all the classes and say, oh, these are the ways that we can learn in the same, in two different classes the same way. So you can really step back and look at the classes and see how you're learning and how they developed. And that's really important.
I'm going, you guys remember in the TLC, I like to use awkward silence as an inspiring factor. So I want you guys to get up and ask questions. In the meantime, while we're pausing and waiting for your courage to motivate your butts to move off the chair, I forgot to introduce some honored guests here this morning. I was nervous about getting my guys started. So you guys may not know, George Mason High School was the first IB Diploma program school in Virginia and one of the first public schools in the United States of America. In the late 1970s, when you were not born and I was five or six, this school system was thinking ahead, 20 years ahead of most school systems in the United States because of a very active community member, Mr. Lou Oldham, who's here in the front with us today. Mr. Oldham worked for the State Department. If you remember from your current 10th grade government class, the State Department deals with our relationship with other countries, so he was aware of what was happening in the rest of the world with education. At that time in U.S. history, we were looking to make schools more vigorous, not rigorous. And Mr. Oldham shared his understanding of IB with the school district. A few light bulbs went off, and some leaders from the school went to learn about it. They realized Mr. Olam's vision was the right path to go on. So I want to welcome Mr. Oldham and thank him for his leadership and give him a round of applause. And the assistant superintendent of Falls Church City, Dr. Gloria Guba, is with us. Where is she hiding? Right there. Dr. Guba is responsible for curriculum in the district, along with a lot of things K through 12. And I want to say I've been here for this is my fourth year here at this school, and Dr. Guba has been an unflinching supporter of IB and a supporter of the way education should be, and we've been very blessed to have her support, and I'm sad to say she will be retiring at the end of the school year, and I know I will miss that support that we have to support you guys and what you're learning. All right, where are my questions? I've got more. Yes, sir.
So I was wondering, people that took the diploma, why did you take the diploma, and did you think that, as opposed to just taking courses that interested you, surely all the courses didn't interest you on the diplomas menu, what made you take the diploma?
Well, I was originally thinking of doing like every class IB except for English, because I absolutely hated English. And I ended up talking with Mr. Mishra, and I came to the realization of I can always start it and then take it going and stop it. It's much harder to not do it and then try to jump in late. And so I ended up just taking English, and then ultimately English became one of my favorite classes. And it was mainly just choosing to do it on your own. And I thought it would ultimately benefit me, and it, as it pans out, it definitely has. So that's kind of why I did the whole diploma.
I knew I wanted to be challenged while I was in high school, and IB sets up a nice structure in order to challenge yourself, and whether that's academically and also extracurricularly.
That goes along with both of them. I actually had like the same experience, but I also knew kind of the person or what career I wanted to go to. Well, not necessarily career, but the ideal of where I wanted to go to. And I knew that that was going to require some development in certain areas.
Maybe good to have another side to that. So Hannah, why did you choose not to do the diploma?
I wanted the flexibility that I think I had with the certificates. I didn't particularly want to take TOK. I didn't want to do an extended essay. And I wanted to take courses that I was interested in more than making sure I had to fill my requirements. I also wasn't planning on taking HL courses as I went into my junior year. I ended up doing two. But I think really the most important thing is to find what works for you and to figure out figure out how much you can take on and don't overextend yourself because you will get burned out. But find the courses that'll challenge you, find the courses that you're interested in, whether that's doing the full diploma or whether that's just taking certificates. You can get just as rigorous an education or vigorous an education in the certificates. You can transfer that to college. You can get pretty much, I think, all of the benefits, especially now that you can do the extended essay and TOK as a certificate student. You can get all the benefits of the IB program in the certificate program. It's really just what works for you.
To make life easier, Michael Irvine, oh no, those mics aren't, we'll use this one. Michael Irvine is senior diploma candidate and IB student advisory board member, will pass the mic to you if you would like to stay in your seat and ask a question, if that makes you more confident and comfortable. In the meantime, if someone who has a question wants to walk up while we're waiting. Any more questions? Let's see. Let's hear from somebody else. I'm sorry about the Eagles. Go ahead. I had to make a football check. Sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. So what was the most interesting IB class that you took?
TOK, hands down. I'd have to say for me. It's kind of redundant, but like the way it's taught, like as a class, I didn't really ever look at it as a class, but more of just a large, like 100-minute discussion of a bunch of really smart, or supposedly we think we're smart people, and the many different viewpoints that I saw like through that class and the ways to learn was just like something I had never even thought about before. Like, 'cause you always think about things like math and other core subjects. And then going into TOK, and then I guess like the most appropriate thing is to have my mind blown, like just like how different everybody thinks, because you don't really think about how other people think.
So. Would someone have a different answer to that question?
I only really did IB art. I mean, my senior year I did IB math studies, but I needed a math credit to graduate, so I figured I might as well take that one. So in all honesty, I really only focused on art because, I mean, since I was like 5, I was the only kid in preschool that wasn't doing stick figures, and like, so I've always been set on having an art career. And to go to an art school, I mean, to be honest, most people there didn't have many, like, they didn't have a lot of IB programs with a lot of the people that I've talked to, and I mean, the minimum GPA to get into the school I go to is like a 2, because they realize that art students are usually really only passionate about art and don't necessarily focus on other things. So I just kind of set myself with that one that I really knew I wanted to do.
For me, besides TOK, my favorite classes were, it was tied between HL Computer Science and HL Biology. HL Computer Science is really fun in the fact that they do something called a dossier, and you write an entire program and analyze your program based upon its memory functionalities and how well it runs and how well it treats errors and whatnot. So I found that really enjoyable. And also HL Biology, I'm thinking to become a doctor, so HL Biology was really helpful in the fact that we did IAs, and it was a further step than SL. I think it's a fundamental step. And the fact that you really extend yourself and learn more in depth what you're going to learn in college and what's going to be helpful in college.
I didn't take TOK, but IB English was definitely one of my favorite classes. I think you should all take IB English, honestly. Diploma, certificate, whatever, take that class. It's such a good class because you read so much literature that you probably wouldn't come in contact with. You have to look at it and think about it in all these different ways, and it's a class that will definitely prepare you for college. I think the reading and writing skills you're going to develop in IB English will benefit you so, so much. So I would recommend taking that class.
And personally, I'm still in the class, but I think that the one the most exciting is IB History, because it kind of expands your knowledge so much. You guys take so many field trips, are engaged with the teacher. You guys do open-end discussions, you watch videos, and you try to actually gain more of an understanding of the whole entire curriculum, not just the IB curriculum, as you also have to take the, this fulfills the history requirement. And that you just get like lots of different perspectives, you get on hands-on learning. I thought that was one of the most exciting.
We have 3 questions. I'll start here, go there, and then over to there. So.
I have a question about doing sports and the IB diploma.
I do softball, and that's a lot of time. Like, sometimes practices are like 2.5 hours, and I'm just, I guess, kind of worried that I'm not going to be able to do softball and the diploma.
You'll definitely be able to play sports and do either IB certificates or the IB diploma. And in fact, a part of the IB diploma is CAS, which, as I'm sure you know, is Community Action and Service. And the action right there is, you know, playing sports, being involved in, you know, exercising your body. So you can definitely, don't worry about being too stressed with sports and IB.
How many of you diploma candidates are state champions? Eric was a sucker.
Yes. No.
Two of you. Okay. Why don't the two of you talk about your athletic experience and the diploma?
Okay. I mean, like Ms. Misha said, I did soccer, and that was like 2 hours a day from February to June, junior and senior year. And even with that commitment, getting home between like 5:30 and 7 on like every weekday, I was still able to get my stuff done and go to bed before the next day started, so midday. So I didn't struggle with it, but then it all ultimately comes back to that huge time management piece. And like, if you waste time on Facebook and things like that, like, you won't get it done. Like, there's no way around it. But like, if you like motivate yourself and you enjoy what you do, and you want to get it all done, then, I mean, I didn't struggle with it at all. So
I think sports are a great, great thing to do in high school. I was a 3-season athlete my junior year and then just a 2-season athlete my senior year. But without sports, I would not have been able to keep my sanity in high school. I think even though you're adding on another activity, you think it's going to stress you out more. But really, I found it that it helps me balance my time more, because that time after school was the way for me to take a break and blow off whatever steam I needed to. And they were just really great in general. And it was stressful at times, but at the end of the day, it was a really beneficial thing for me to have sports in my life.
And
so definitely
also,
do softball.
Okay. Also, if I can add a point, like for CAS, they say that action, I know a lot of people refer to that sport, but you really don't have to do sports. There are a variety of ways that you can do. You just have to be active. Like, I don't play sports, but I am actively involved and do activity. And that's one way to fill that cash part. So that shouldn't discourage you from taking the IB diploma program.
70% of diploma candidates play at least one varsity sport. A lot are 3-season athletes as well. There was a question there with the portable microphone.
My question is, do colleges recognize and give credit for the diploma? Like, does it always count? Because some people say that it doesn't.
It depends on the college. Some have more stringent requirements and some don't. So you'll have to look into that depending on your school. I found that regardless of whether or not your school will recognize and give you credit, you will be prepared for that class. And to me, that was what was most important, was whether or not I was prepared.
My school recognized certificate courses for credit, so I came in with 23 credit hours, which is 7 classes and 2 labs, and like 24 credit hours puts you at a sophomore level. So I came in almost a sophomore my freshman year just because of the IB I had taken. And like that's definitely a huge plus. As a double major, that means I had most of my gen eds out of the way so I could get right into my major courses and I can still graduate on time. Even if they don't recognize it, it'll help you. I took SL Computer Science in high school, and that was one of the courses that didn't transfer to my school, so I took the introductory computer science course, but I had learned everything in that course already. So even if you don't get credit for it, it'll make your classes much easier because it's something that you might have had experience with already. And also, it will just set you up for all of your classes.
I mean, I also want to add this. More and more colleges are accepting the diploma and the certificates as credits. I mean, I came in, I got 15 credits, which is, at South Carolina, a full semester. So that got rid of, like, a large chunk of time. And even with the 2 classes I didn't get, so bio and math, like everybody's been saying, like, you already basically know the stuff they're teaching. So it becomes a lot easier to just take those classes, and I don't want to say less effort's involved because you always have to put effort out, but it's an easier transition, I guess, would be to say, to go to college. when you take the IB and get credits for it?
I know at the University of Virginia, they're pretty stringent on the criteria for accepting IB credits, but I know that legislation has been passed in Virginia so that more Virginia schools are accepting IB credits. For me, I got 27 credits, which is almost a full year at UVA. And although I know some kids who have gotten almost 60 credits, but I don't really find that there's a big difference. I feel more prepared, personally. Most of them have been doing dual enrollment, though, so that's a little bit different.
So let me ask you guys this. I always argue to students, and you guys can tell me if I'm wrong, that you might not get as much credit as maybe a student did 12 AP classes. But I have found year after year after year of meeting graduates that they're not angry about it because of that preparation that they feel. And that credits only count for electives. So if you get 60, you don't really get to use 60 credits, actually. Am I right or wrong about the claim I make to these students?
Well, in terms of that claim, I'd say it depends on the school. But the most important thing is actually something that we learned in TOK, or we discussed. And that's if you're accomplishing anything, the little medal you get at the end or the little credit that you get on your transcript isn't the goal. That's not what you should be aiming for. What you're aiming for is the accomplishment. And the accomplishment of the IB diploma or IB classes is that you'll be prepared for college. You'll have been stretching your mind, engaging with these very vigorous classes. And it'll make a huge difference in your life and in your college life. So don't stress so much about, oh, you know, this one school might not accept these credits, so I shouldn't take a class. Take what you're interested in, and you're going to grow from it.
I mean, I will say this. I had 6 credits taken back. They told me I was going to get credit for bio and math, and then halfway through the semester took it back. And I was mad at first about it, but then, like Mr. Meijer said, like, it really doesn't matter a whole amount, just because, like, I know that I did it, and it's really, like, I'll eventually have to do it again, but it's whatever. Like, it's not really about the medal. It's about the journey.
The credit helps. Like, it helps that I don't have to take any English at school, and I tested out of the first 2 semesters of French. But I think the benefits of IB outweigh, like, even had I not got any credit, there's so much that you get from IB. You learn how to read, you learn how to write a paper, you know, you learn how to manage your time. IB in high school taught me how to manage my time so that, like, now I can go to school and I can take 9 or 10 classes a semester and I can handle that because of you've got a really solid foundation in high school, which will set you up. So even if you don't get credit, I think everything else that you'll learn from the IB program will definitely make it worth your time.
Eleanor.
I have a question that's sort of similar to the sports question about not being able to do sports. I've found that as my course schedule has gotten more rigorous and meaning more and more time to do homework, I'm seeing my family less and less, and I know my mom, who only sees me on the weekends, really complains about that. And so I was wondering how the IB and the increased workload really affects your family life. And if you find yourself growing more detached from your family because of that, or how that affects.
I think that's the best question I've ever heard in doing this in 4 years.
Yeah, that's.
Well, I guess I could answer that. I take pretty rigorous courses that are challenging and require quite a bit of work. But I don't find that. I do, like, one time I did shut myself in my room, but that was because I didn't necessarily prepare and have good time management with that assignment. So it really has to do with time management. And also, if your family is quite supportive of you taking the IB diploma, they'll try to help you, they'll probably be understanding, or try some way to help you study, practice your presentation, and spend time with you. And all, of course, you can take a break. You're just going to have to know that you're going to have to take some more time to finish it later.
It just comes down to time management again. I mean, yes. I know we're saying that a lot, but really, if you make something a priority in your life, you can get it done. And so whether that's, you know, going to bed at 10:30 or if that's spending time with your family, if you really want to do it, you can do it. It's going to take a lot of discipline and it's going to take a lot of focus. But, I mean, if you make spending time with your family a priority, it'll happen. We had dinner together pretty much every night when I was in high school. I would, you know, go on a hike with my dad. You can do everything that you want to. It might not be easy, but you can make it happen.
Sometimes perfectionism is the enemy of mental and spiritual health. Peter, would you like to share how you handled that idea when you were in high school? You've shared it before.
Well,
I just, if it became too much, I just didn't do it. So, so like, everyone's human here, and you put in a good effort, and most of the time it was not too much, and you just do what you need to do. So, but just to be real, let's have some real talk. Like, if there's an essay and I procrastinated on it and it was taking too much, and there was something that I decided was more important that night, like if it was a hard, if you know, I needed to be with my family or whatever, then I'd just say, I'm gonna do a worse job on this, you know, on this essay, or even better, like, and, you know, I could talk to my teacher and say, hey, and it's all, it's, hey, you know, I had this thing, and can I have another day to do it? Well, I'll take the 3 points off. I'd rather write a great essay and get, you know, 3 points off than or whatever it is, like whatever you take off then, and still have time with my family or still do what I needed to do, or still, a big thing with me was I really liked working on projects, and I knew I was not gonna be someone who liked being assigned things. And so I used to run the variety shows, and I just liked that more than most of my classes. So if it was a variety show week, I would just work on the variety show. And so you can make that decision, and you try to find a balance, and you try to decide what consequences you're willing to accept for what happens, and you just own up to them. And the key is, and hopefully you can develop authentic, non-contractual relationships with your teachers and peers. So like if you develop authentic relationships with your teachers and you're not using, you know, if you're not using them or manipulating them, you can ask for things and you can negotiate and you can figure things out. This isn't, and the reason I say that authentic thing at the end is this isn't like licensed to, you know, be manipulative and play on people's kindness to you, but it's like, but if you take it really sincerely and seriously that you're part of a learning community here, you're gonna make it work and you're gonna find balance and you're gonna know that there are a lot of priorities in your life, one of which is doing well in school, one of which is each of the specific classes that inspire you, one of which is your extracurriculars, one of which is, you know, your projects.
Yeah, and we'll get to you in a second, but I keep a calendar that helps me kind of prep, and when there is like a conflict, I go straight to the teacher and like ask for maybe for like an extension, or if we can, for even if like there's a group of people who have a conflict that day, she'll move it. But again, you gotta be considerate. You cannot come 2 days before it's due and you've had this project for 2 weeks to say, hey, can I get an extension, or can we just move this date? Because then you weren't necessarily considerate about their time and their own management.
I think the Peter and Christina hit the nail on the head. Your teachers have said multiple times, and you guys have shared, creating authentic communication, you know, talking to each other about what's going on in your lives. We don't always know what's going on in the lives of students. Thank you so much.
Well, I guess the thing that kind of puts me off of the IB diploma is the extended essay, just because I tend to have trouble making my ideas concise or expanding on things depending on the topic. So I just wanted to know, like, what are your experiences with the writing the extended essay and the process of it?
You can always choose certificates. Like, you don't have to do the extended essay. If that's really something that you don't want to do, you don't have to. If you want the IB diploma, I would say don't let the extended essay or any particular part of the IB diploma turn you off. I think you know what I'm trying to say. Like, don't let one thing prevent you from doing it, because your teachers will help you, Mr. Mishra will help you if you really want to do that diploma. Like, people will make sure that you get it done as long as you reach out and you ask for help and you make it a priority.
I was really nervous about doing the extended essay, and I found it kind of daunting and intimidating, but I was really surprised by the end of the experience of how I rose to the occasion, and that was something that was really satisfying and gratifying to me. And so I guess I would encourage all of you that if that is something that is on your heart, that I think you two guys will rise to the occasion.
I have to say, like everyone else, I was really nervous about the extended essay, but I was able to do something that I was really passionate about, which was marine biology. I had never taken a course, but I had just known, you know, from day one, I wanted to, you know, explore my passion a little bit more. So I actually did coral bleaching, and I was able to interview professors, and I got so into it that it just didn't even matter that I had to write, I don't know, 20 pages. I had such a good time. I really learned something about myself, that I was really into marine biology, and I did want to, you know, further investigate that passion in college. So I thought it was a really good experience for me.
For me, the extended essay, you get so much time to do it that, yeah, it is a 15-page paper at the end of it, but the process is, over a year, roughly?
It's a year, exactly.
It's a year. I mean, if you think about it, 365 days to write 15 pages, is an enormously large amount of time. And if everybody's been saying, if you find something you're passionate about, it's not really work in the sense. I mean, I did my extended essay in, 3 days. the research took a lot longer, but the writing it, I just sat down and wrote it, and it really wasn't that hard. I mean, it's kind of long, but it was almost fun. And then after you've written it, and when you get to college, all the papers at college seem like no big deal. Like when they say, oh, we need a 7-page paper in a week and a half, well, you're like, well, I wrote a 15-page paper 6 months ago. Like, that's not really that hard. It makes you realize that, you're more prepared for college by doing it. And so I definitely think that the pros for the extended essay outweighed the cons of it.
Yeah, and like at just another moment, that this isn't something that you're doing by yourself. As it was explained to me, you have consistent help. You have advisors, people who are checking you, people who are helping you with your research, answering any of your questions, and you can seek outside help, which I think that you did. So it's not anything that's really difficult or you're taking on your own or really big challenge that you're not sure how you're going to complete it. It's been a couple of months that they've been talking about this, and I'm already kind of relieved, oh, this is no biggie. So it's really not that hard.
Our final question from Austin.
My only question is, do you guys have any sort of regrets or things that you would have done differently, when doing the IB diploma and in high school, in terms of how you managed your times and what classes you took?
In terms of registering for classes, I'd say that the biggest regret I have for myself is that I stressed way too much over which classes that I would take. And you guys have, as Mr. Misha was telling us, some even more IB classes are being offered. So there are tons of different classes that you can choose from. And I sort of stressed myself out thinking, oh, maybe because my friends are taking this class, I need to take it, or I'm supposed to take it. And what it really comes down to is the IB classes are a great way to learn. The teachers at George Mason are phenomenal. You guys, no matter what class you take, it's going to be taught extremely well. And, you can branch out and take a class that you're interested in without worrying that, oh, it's not the right one. So don't feel that there's a certain puzzle piece class list that you have to go to, then you're locked into that, there's no option. Just try out different classes and then it'll work out.
I think if I could change anything, I would actually take more IB classes. I'm very happy with my decision to be a certificate student. I wouldn't change that, but I would probably go back and take TOK because I think I would have benefited a lot from that, and I might have taken IB history. But I don't think there's really anything that I regret. I really enjoyed all the classes I took and I really learned a lot from them.
I've previously said about my CAS, one of the things I probably would have changed is how I treated CAS and how I would manage it and how I wouldn't try to just acquire as many activities as I could and probably just limit that down. And furthermore, I wanted to expand a little bit more on my extended essay. My extended essay experience was a little bit different. I wrote my extended essay during my summer, and then I came back to school to find out that my extended essay it wouldn't be received by IB. So I had to write another extended essay. So I had to write two extended essays, which that one ended up to be 34 pages entirely. That's with graphs and everything, so that's not a typical extended essay. The thing I regret about that is that I didn't spend enough time on it, I would say. I really enjoyed my extended essay experience. I spent a lot of time speaking with fellow classmates, and Mr. Snyder in particular, because he was my advisor. So the only thing I would really change about the extended essay is probably spending more time on it. I really enjoyed it. I really found my own topic. I was really passionate about my topic. It ended up to be a mathematical analysis of blackjack, so I found that very interesting.
I regret not taking even more seriously the concepts, even starting in 10th grade, so this is a good time to catch you to say this. taking more seriously the concept that classes, and especially IB classes based on IB's mission statement, should be, you know, true learning communities where everyone's an active engager in them. And you waste so much time in high school, and there are so many great classes and teachers at George Mason, but we wasted a lot of time just complaining a lot. Like at lunch, you just complain about this, you complain about this assignment, you complain about this class, and you have two you've basically two options when you complain. One is you complain and then you talk behind the teacher's back, and then you just take it, you know? And that's what most of us do, and that's what I did most of the time. And another option is, after complaining, really taking seriously and sincerely the concept that these are learning communities, and you can add to the class. You can be an active teacher in the class as well. You can meet with, I'm sure, all of your teachers, if they're living up to the IB mission statement, they would love to meet with you to talk about what ideas you have for the class, what curriculum, what units you want to cover, what books you want to read, what ways to run the class on certain days you want to do, what type of discussions you want to have, what questions you want to ponder. And if you just really took that seriously and sincerely talked to your teachers about that, every time you find yourself at lunch complaining about a teacher, maybe just stop yourself and say, hey, let's schedule a meeting with the teacher and say, hey, it would be great if next Thursday we talked about this, or if we read more of these books or things like that. That would have made it a much more vigorous experience. But even saying that, though, it was really a great experience, and that's mostly in a minority case. But in those minority cases, really take it seriously to be an authentic participator.
We are about to conclude. Did you have a question? Maybe you could have one student answer that question. Go ahead.
I was wondering what you liked the least about the program.
I'm in one class. I can't answer that.
Can I answer? I think the thing I liked the least was the fact that there's such a pressure to take IB and to do the IB diploma, especially there's this whole concept that, like, if you're not in IB classes or if you're not doing the IB diploma, like, you're not good enough, you're not smart enough, you're not going to get into college. And that's totally not true. I didn't do the IB diploma. I got into college. I got credit. I think there's just so much pressure to, you have to, you know, have the 5.0 GPA and you have to play a varsity sport and you have to do all of this to be successful, and that's not true. So if you are really passionate about a course, take that course. If you want to play a sport, play the sport. Don't do things because it's expected of you. Don't do things because your parents want you or your peers are doing it, because then you won't really be getting the most out of it. But find what you're passionate about and challenge yourself.
Can I throw something in really quickly?
Yes.
Okay, so even if you're not really planning on doing the diploma, what I did, I don't know if you guys have heard about it yet or anything, but I did the Arlington Career Center. And so even if you just want to do a certificate, if you have something you're already really passionate about, they have a lot of options for you, and they can also sort of help you with the classes you're going to be taking for IB. And sometimes your IB class will help you with the class you might want to take there. So that's really good, because my junior year I did graphics for the web, so I worked in Photoshop, Illustrator, Flash, and all that. That really helped me for my senior year and my junior year in IB art. And then my senior year I did photography, and I actually got a credit for that, so next semester I'm skipping on to photo too. So I'm going to be working on this, like, all the sophomores in my school. So even if you're not, like, kind of certain if you want to do the diploma, then certificate and Arlington Career Center is definitely a good kind of balance, because it's also really fun, so.
I think that was a great question and great answers to end on. If you guys remember the vocab word we talked about in the sessions in your gym class, it was about intrinsic motivation. And I think that's what these two students talked about. Look to yourself and what you're intrinsically motivated to do. You know you have a lot of support. We're really excited to see where the class of 2014 heads in the next 2 years. Thank you so much for your time this morning. I hope you found the feedback valuable. Let's give our panelists a loud round of applause, please.